San Francisco at the huge Boeing aircraft plant in Seattle, Washington, American workers also stay on the job. Hearing the good news of Germany's surrender, these men and women completed an extra B-29 Super Fortress. They cheer the great bomber on its way to blast Japan. From now on, the only target for United States military might.
Of dollars pouring into the hands of the American worker. Now, in the mind of the average worker live two separate personalities. One, the thrifty.
Wait a bit, laddie. You're going to save a bit of that, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Oftentimes, idle money burns a hole in your pocket, which brings out the other personality, the spendthrift.
Hi, big shot. Come on with me. I'll show you how to spend your dough.
Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy!
I got a couple of good beats.
But, laddie, I've got some better dates.
Important ones, too. When every American should pay his or her income tax gladly and proudly. This year, thanks to Hitler and Hirohito, taxes are higher than ever before. Will you have enough money on hand to meet your payments when they fall due?
We'll take care of that later. Forget it, forget it.
But you don't want to forget our fighting men, do you?
No, sir.
Then you'll have to start saving right away to meet your tax payments.
Yeah. Listen, chum. Spend it. It's your dough.
Yeah, it's my dough.
Aye, laddie. It's your dough. But it's your war, too. You must save for victory.
What's money for? Spend it. Shoot the works.
Nay, nay, you must save it. Spend. Save.
Spend, save, spend, save, spend, save, spend, save, spend, 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 save.
Well, now what are you going to do? Just remember, every dollar you spend for something you don't need is a dollar spent to help the Axis. That's right. And every dollar you sock away for taxes is another dollar to sock the Axis. For it is your taxes, my taxes, our taxes that run the factories.
This is our fight. The fight for freedom. Freedom of speech. Of worship, freedom from want and fear. Taxes will keep democracy on the march.
Well, golly, Mr. Hall, I don't know the answers to all those questions. I just know that I'm in love with Sue. Is that bad?
No, that's good.
Sure. And it's good when you recognize that you don't know the answers. It's a good sign.
I don't know. I think we're friends. And maybe we can understand marriage, but backgrounds, how do they affect getting married?
Well, come over here a minute. Perhaps I can show you what I mean.
What's that?
I call it a marriage development board. It represents the psychological distance between a husband and a wife from the time they are born until they die.
What does it all mean?
Well, let's set it up for you and Sue. When you are born, you inherit a great many differences from your parents. That's part of your background.
That makes sense, all right.
Now, as you grow up, you each develop separate and unique personalities. Your mental growth, your emotional outlook, your standards and ideals. Larry, your distinctly masculine outlook on life, and Sue, your feminine way of looking at things, your capacities to love and be loved. In these and many other ways, you each acquire a background, so that when you first met, you were probably farther apart, probably more distinct individuals than when you were born.
But I don't want to marry a girl like me. I want to marry a man like him.
So even though we're close together here, We don't know how far apart we are there.
That's right. When you two met, there was probably an early physical reaction. A romantic attraction that pulled you together. A love appeal that hits you sort of... boing.
How did you know?
Well, it happened to me. It happens in some degree to most couples who become happily married. But it takes more than this boing. For you see, if you're too far apart psychologically, if your backgrounds are not similar enough, it can cause a great deal of argument and unhappiness until...
it's gone!
Where'd it go?
That's what you'll be saying about your romantic love if these other things cause a breakup.
Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!
Now in complete control of the government of this state, I made no campaign promises, because until a few weeks ago, I had no hope of being elected. Now, however, I have something more than a hope. And Jim Geddes has something less than a chance. Every straw vote, every independent poll shows that I'll be elected. Very well then. Now I can afford to make some promises.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. There is no blinking at the fact that our people, our territory, and our interests are in grave danger. With confidence in our armed forces, with the unbounding determination of our people, we will gain the inevitable triumph, so help us God. I ask that the Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
What about this?
Ian? Well, how about a date?
Well, really, no thanks, Woody.
And cover!
Be sure and remember what Bert the Turtle just did, friends, because every one of us must remember to do the same thing. That's what this film is all about. Duck and cover. Paul and Patty know this. No matter where they go or what they do, they always try to remember what to do if the atom bomb explodes right then. It's a bomb. Duck and cover. Sundays, holidays, vacation time, we must be ready every day, all the time, to do the right thing if the atomic bomb explodes. Duck and cover. That's the first thing to do. Duck and cover. First, you duck. And then, you cover. You duck and cover tight. Duck and cover under the table. It's a bomb. Duck and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You.
And you.
And you.
And you.
Duck and cover.
Well, suppose he did it this way.
Hi, Ann. What you doing Saturday night?
Well, I guess I'm busy.
Oh, yeah? Any chance of giving him the brush off for me?
Well, of all the nerve!
Good morning, girls. I'm going to talk to you this morning about the way you look. Now, I've heard it said that we women attach too much importance to our appearance. But that isn't true. After all, the way we look exerts so much influence on the way we feel and on the way other people feel about us that it really is very important. Good health and intelligent physical care are the foundations of all beauty. We all want a lovely skin, shining eyes, a beautiful smile, and loads of pep. But we can't have them except in a healthy, clean body. And I mean clean. Sleep comes next to cleanliness as a beauty base. And I mean sleep. Not just going to bed, if that means sitting up writing letters or listening to music. I've seen lots of sparkling eyes and good complexion sacrificed to swing records at bedtime. Mind you, I'm all for music in its place. But there is a lot of sound sense in that old expression, beauty sleep. So snap out that light early enough every night to get 8 or 9 hours of this most effective beauty treatment.
What cigarette do you smoke, Doctor?
Tens of thousands of doctors in all branches of medicine, in all parts of the country, were asked that question.
What cigarette do you smoke, Doctor?
The brand named most was Camel. Yes, surveys show more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette.
Smoke Camels, the cigarette so many doctors enjoy.
Well, is there another way?
Ann? This is Woody. Well, I have a ticket for the High Team Carnival Saturday, and... Well, would you like to go?
Why, yes, Woody. I'll have to talk to my folks about it. But I think I can go. That'll be fun.
Yeah. Well, shall I pick you up about 8 o'clock?
That's fine, Woody. 8 o'clock Saturday. I think it'll be all right, but I'll let you know for sure. Bye. A date with Woody. Saturday.
Direction of the President of the United States, stay in your homes, I repeat, stay in your homes.
Then, Dimitri, you know how we've always talked about the possibility of something going wrong with the bomb. The bomb, Dimitri. The hydrogen bomb. Well, now, what happened is one of our base commanders, he had a sort of, well, he went a little funny in the head. You know, just a little funny. And he went and did a silly thing. Well, I'll tell you what he did. He ordered his planes to attack your country. Well, let me finish, Dimitri. Well, listen, how do you think I feel about it?
Maybe not today, maybe not tomorrow, but soon and for the rest of your life.
But what about us?
We'll always have Paris.